So good morning, everyone. So I'll be starting with a quick revision on properties and solution of triangles. So first I'll start with properties of triangle. Properties of triangle. What is solution of triangle? Solution, the word solution is used when you want to find out something, right? Solution of an equation. So you're finding out the roots of the equation. In the same way, solution of a triangle is when you're trying to figure out a triangle from its certain known parameters. That is something which we'll do in the second part of our discussion today. So properties of triangle, there are certain theorems, laws, which we need to know. Most of it you already know, so I'll be slightly faster with respect to that. The first thing is the sine rule or the sine formula. Sine rule or the sine formula. And do let me know if you want me to do, I will of course derive a lot of formulas here, but if you need the derivation of basic formulas also, do let me know. Okay, so sine rule says A by, in any triangle, A by sine A is equal to B by sine B is equal to C by sine C. However, everybody here knows how a triangle is basically named. So when you are trying to name a triangle, let's distort this. Yeah. The side opposite to angle A is called small a. The side opposite to angle B is called small b. Side opposite to angle C is called small c. So in any triangle, this law is going to be true. And this ratio is actually 2r. Okay, r is the circumcircle radius. Circumcircle radius. Okay. The derivation of it is very simple. Let's say this is your circumcenter. Okay. And if you, I'm not drawing the circle over here. I hope you can imagine that there is a circle which is passing like this. Okay. So if you drop a perpendicular, remember this angle is A. So this whole angle is 2A. So this angle is AA each. Okay. And this length, let's say I call this as OB. OB is R, OC is also R. Okay. And we know that the circumcircle center is obtained by perpendicularly bisecting the sides. So this length and this length will be equal to A by 2 each. Okay. So on this triangle, let me call this as OBM. So in triangle OBM, if you apply basic trigonometry, you will realize sine of A becomes A by 2 by R. So it's A by 2R. So 2R becomes A by sine A. Similarly, by dropping a perpendicular on AC and AB, you can figure out the other two ratios as well. So this is your sine rule. Cosine rule. Cosine rule says that in any triangle, these three formulas will be valid. So any of the three formulas can be asked. Okay. Again, the proof for this is very simple. So I'll just make a triangle over here. Okay. Yeah. Let's say this is your angle A, B, C. Let me drop a perpendicular. This is small c, small b, small a. Now, if you look at the triangle, let me call this as P. If you look at the triangle ABP, this side length would be actually C cos A. Okay. And this side length will be C sin A. Right. So the CP length, which will be left off, will be B minus C cos A. And since this is also a right angle triangle, so in triangle BPC, you can apply Pythagoras theorem. So C sin A square B minus C cos A square is equal to A square. If you expand this, you'll get B square. You'll get minus 2BC cos A. And you'll get C square cos square and C square sin square, which will be actually a C square. Okay. So from here, you can make cos A the subject of the formula. You'll automatically get B square plus C square minus A square by 2BC. So that proves the first part of the formula. Similarly, others can also be proven. Okay. Any question here? Because I'm slightly faster here. If you feel that you want explanation for something, please feel free to stop me. Especially HSR people.
So can you drag up?
Drag up, okay. Okay. Because of the sine rule, you can write your side in terms of angles like this. So this is a connection between the side and the angles connected by the circumcircle radius. So this is very important, very highly used. Many books will write K for 2R because sometimes they will get cancelled. So you don't need them exactly. Okay, can I go to the next page?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Next is your projection formula. Projection formulae, we said, because they come in triads. So projection formula says in any triangle, C is equal to A cos B plus B cos A. B is equal to A cos C plus C cos A. And A is equal to B cos C plus C cos B. It can be easily be proved. So let's say this is a... So let's say this is a triangle ABC. Drop a perpendicular from A onto BC. Okay. Now you can see that. This length BM, let's say this is angle B, this length BM is C cos B because of the triangle ABM. And this length MC would be B cos C because this angle is C. And if you use this triangle AMC, this will be B cos C. So together, if you add it, that is BM plus MC, it makes your side A. And hence, A is nothing but B cos C plus C cos B, which proves the C part of your formula. And similarly, others can also be proven. Okay. Any questions here? Any questions in this case?
No, sir.
Okay. So, let's say we take a problem. So whatever we have done so far, we'll take a question on this. In a triangle, angle A is 55 degree, angle B is 15 degree, angle C is 110 degree. Then C square minus A square is which of the following options? I'm going to run the poll for this. Yeah, Venkat, every morning I have it. Not a new thing for me.
Oh, okay, sir.
It's becoming cold also.
This is nice, sir. This is there.
So quite an old concept for all of you. Trigonometry is something that you have done almost 1.5 years back. But yes, you constantly deal with it while you're solving other topics also. Done? All right, we'll not give a lot of time to such questions. 2 minutes is what is expected. I've just got 4 votes so far. We'll close this in another 30 seconds. As I've already discussed, we have a lot of concepts to cover. Five, four, three, two, one, go. Okay. Most of you have gone with option number A. Let's check. See, we already discussed that I can write C as 2R sine C. And I can write A as 2R sine A as per our sine rule. Isn't it? So C square minus A square, I can write it as 4R square sine square C minus sine square A. Correct? We already know that the sine square C minus sine square A formula is basically nothing but sine C plus A into sine C minus A. Okay, don't forget your basic identities. Okay, so sine of C plus A would be sine of C plus A will be 165 degrees. And sine of C minus A would be sine of 55 degrees. Okay, now sine of 65 degrees and sine of 55 degrees. Can we write this in this way? Sine of 15 degrees into sine of 55 degrees, because sine of theta is sine 180 minus theta. So you can split up 2R sine 15 and 2R sine 55. 2R sine 15 will automatically become your B, and 2R sine 55 will automatically become your A. Yes or no? So this becomes AB. Option number A is correct. Okay. Is it fine? Any questions? Any concerns? Next. Okay, let's take this. All right, so this question is, a circle of area 20 square units is centered at O. Suppose triangle ABC is inscribed in that circle and has an area of 8 square units. The central angles alpha, beta, gamma are as shown in the figure. Find the value of sine alpha, sine beta, sine gamma. Sine alpha plus sine beta plus sine gamma. Again, let's have a time limit of 2.5 minutes, not more than that. Poll is on. Good, good. Okay, last 20 seconds. Five, four, three, two, one, go. All right, most of you have gone with option number B, B for Bengaluru. Let's check. See, if you want to find the area of the triangle ABC, or if you want to relate the area of the triangle ABC, let's figure out the area of each of these small triangles which comprise that triangle. So let's say this triangle, if I talk about, this triangle will have area half into. Now, in a triangle, we know that if I know the two sides and a sandwiched angle, okay, then area of such a triangle is given by half xy sine of the sandwiched angle, right? This is something which is supposed to be known to you. So this area will be half r square sine beta, correct? Similarly, this area which I'm shading with orange, that would be half r square sine gamma. And this angle which I'm shading with blue, that would be half r square sine alpha. Together they will make up your, bigger triangle ABC. So I can say half r square sine alpha sine beta sine gamma will make up your triangle, which is having an area of 20 square units.
Sir, 8 square units.
8 square units. Sorry. 8 square units. And we have been given the area of the circle also. So I can find my capital R square from there. So pi capital R square is 20. So R square is 20 by pi. So if you put it over here, 10 by pi times sine alpha, sine beta, sine gamma is given to us as 8. That clearly means sine alpha, sine beta, sine gamma has to be 4 pi by 5. 4 pi by 5. Option number A is correct, which did not get enough votes. I think A only got 17% of the votes. Is this clear? Any questions? All right. So with this, yes, sir.
So 1 second, I'm writing.
Sure, Dhyan.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Then, okay. Next is your tangent law. So sine law, cosine law, and now the tangent law or tangent rule, whatever you call it. Tangent rule, also called as the Napier's analogy. Napier's analogy. And this is basically not a very important concept, but you'll find its application to a certain extent in the solution of triangles part. So as of now, I'll give you what are the rules. So it says that tan of A minus B by 2 is A minus B by A plus B cot C by 2. Similarly, you can say tan of, let's say if you want to write B minus C by 2, you can choose any difference of the angle over here by 2, but accordingly this will change. So B minus C by B plus C and cot of whatever angle is left off. So let's say A is left off, so A by 2. Similarly, if you can write tan of A minus C by 2. So here you'll have A minus C by A plus C and whatever angle is left off by 2. Okay. This proof is very easy. Just one of them, I'll prove it very quickly. It comes from the sine rule only. So if you just talk about, let me write A. Yeah. If you just talk about the first formula, A minus B by A plus B, as per the sine rule, I can write it as 2R sine A minus sine B by 2R sine A plus sine B. And you can use your transformation formula. Sine A minus sine B is 2 cos A plus B by 2 into sine A minus B by 2. Similarly, 2 sine a plus b by 2 cos a minus b by 2. If you cancel this off, on the right hand side, you clearly see tan a minus b by 2 divided by tan a plus b by 2. Okay. So if you make tan a minus b by 2 the subject of the formula, it becomes a minus b by a plus b times tan a plus b by 2. Now we are dealing with a triangle, so we know a plus b plus c is 180 degrees. So a plus b by 2 is 90 degree minus c by 2. So tan of a plus b by 2 is going to be cot of c by 2. So this thing over here, you can replace that with cot of c by 2, and there you go. So this gives you the desired rule, a minus b by a plus b into cot of c by 2. Right? So we'll not take any question on this. We'll take questions when we are doing the solution of triangles. Next thing that we are going to talk about, which probably most of you would not have done so far, is your concept of, let me take one question. I think one question I can take. Let's say, in a triangle ABC, side length A is 2 times side B, and it is known that mod of the difference of angle A and B is pi by 3. Question is find angle C. Acha. You still remember that? Sir, how could we forget those torturous moments? Yeah, just a simple question on the tangent law. See, if the time permits, we'll take a lot of questions, but my immediate concern is to let you know all the wherewithals. Very good, Shomik. Good, Ruchir. Yeah, so if you use your formula directly, you can get this in one shot. Yeah. Now see, the moment they say A is 2B, you know that the side length A is more than the side length B. So in a triangle, the side which has got the longest, you can say the greatest side will have the greatest angle opposite to it. So angle A has to be greater than angle B because of this relation. And because of this, the mod of this will change just to A minus B. Okay. So mod here will become redundant because side A is more than side B. So angle A also has to be more than angle B. Right. So now we can directly use our Napier's analogy here. So this will become A minus B by A plus B cot of C by 2. This is already pi by 6 and A is already 2B. Okay. So pi by 6 is 1 by root 3 and this guy is going to be 1 by 3 cot of C by 2. So from here we get tan of C by 2 is equal to 1 by root 3. So C by 2 has to be pi by 6. So C has to be pi by 3. Done. Is this fine? Any questions here? Any concerns? All right. Now we go to the trigonometric ratios for half angles, what we call as the auxiliary formula. Why it is called the auxiliary formula? Because it comes from your basic laws only, which you have already studied. The sine rule, cosine rule, etc. So let's have these formulas as well. So let me start with half angles of sine of angles A, B, and C. Okay. So sine A by 2 is under root of S minus B, S minus C by BC. This is given as S minus A, S minus C by AC. And this is given as S minus A, S minus B by AB. Easy way to remember this is in sine, you realize whatever angle is here, the side which is not corresponding to that angle is present over here, BC, BC. Since angle B is here, AC, AC, like this. Okay. Let's prove this. One of them, I'll prove it very quickly. Let's say I want to prove the first one. So it comes from your cosine formula. So you all know that cos of A is B square plus C square minus A square by 2BC. Okay. Cos square A is known to be 1 minus 2 sine square A by 2. Correct. So let us make sine square A by 2 the subject of the formula. So it'll become 1 minus, that is, I'm bringing it to the left side, and half of this. Okay. So this becomes nothing but 2BC minus B square plus C square plus A square by 4BC. This is equal to sine square A by 2. Now this term over here is actually A square minus B minus C the whole square. Check it out. Correct? This is sine square A by 2. So if you apply x square minus y square formula on the numerator, it becomes A plus B minus C, and it becomes A minus B plus C by 4BC. Sine square A by 2. Now, we all know that S is the semi-perimeter of the triangle. Okay. So 2S is A plus B plus C. So A plus B minus C is equal to 2S minus 2C. So 2S minus 2C. So this will be similarly 2S minus 2B by 4BC sine square A by 2. Okay. So this will become S minus B, S minus C by BC. And take the under root without having to take plus minus, because in any triangle, sine A by 2 will be positive. This will always be positive. So don't have to take plus minus symbol over here. Just a plus will be sufficient. Okay. See, why I'm telling you the derivation is because formula may ditch you sometime, and let's say in very dire situation, you may need to derive it. So you should know from where it is coming. Okay. I can play the role of giving the formula for you, but then it will be no difference for you to attend this class and see probably a Arihant formula, that black book. So all formulas are there also. Okay. So this is how this formula is derived. Is this to be remembered? I would say yes, because it will save a lot of time for you in the exam if at all you need it. So make a note of this. This is for the sine of the half angles. Similarly, there will be a formula for the cos of the half angles, which I'll be giving you on the next page. Have you copied this? Can I go to the next page? Okay. So second set of formula is cos of A by 2, cos of B by 2, cos of C by 2. So cos of A by 2 is under root of S minus A by BC. Okay. Now the way to remember it is, it should have the same denominator as the sine A by 2 term. And whatever angle is present is the same angle present over here. Now, most of you would be thinking that itself is a formula for me. Okay. So similarly, S minus B and AC. Or you can say whatever is not present. Whichever angle is used, the side which is corresponding to the other two angles, that is that has to be present in the denominator. Similarly, SS minus C by AB. Now, the proof is exactly similar as what we did for the previous one. Instead of writing cos A as 1 minus 2 sine square A by 2, use this formula. I'm not going to derive it. I'm just going to write the expression. So in this formula, all you need to do is change your cos A with 2 cos square A by 2 minus 1. Okay. And from here you proceed, you'll end up getting your cos A by 2 expression like this. Okay. So please proceed as a homework question on this. Is this fine? And similarly, we have a formula for tan of half angles as well. First, make a note of this. All right, so tan half angle is, you don't have to do anything extra over here. If you know your sine half angle and if you know your cos half angle, this will be automatically be there. So sine half angle was sine A by 2 was sine S minus B, S minus C by BC. And cos of A by 2 was SS minus A by BC. Okay, so BC and BC will go off and you'll end up getting S minus B, S minus C by SS minus A. Okay. Now, this is something which many people also remember it as delta by SS minus A. Okay. How very simple. All you need to do is within the brackets, you multiply with SS minus A. So this will become S square. Okay. And we all know that this is the this expression is delta square by Heron's formula. So it becomes delta square by S square S minus A the whole square under root. So this becomes delta by S S minus A. Okay. From here itself, you will get a formula which we'll do in some time. And that formula is tan A by 2. Delta by S is actually known to be small r. That is your in-circle radius. So this formula comes from here. Okay. So they're all interlinked. This we'll do later in today's discussion. Don't worry. Is this fine? Similarly, without much ado, we'll write down the formula of tan B by 2. So tan B by 2 formula is under root of S minus A, S minus C by S minus B, and tan of C by 2 formula is under root of S minus A S minus B by S S minus C. Okay, so we'll take up few questions where we'll be learning how to apply them.
Sir, can you drag to the right?
Yeah, sure.
Sir, what did you say R was here?
Oh, R was the in-circle radius. So basically, when you have a triangle and you inscribe a circle within it, that circle is called the in-circle. So this circle will have all the sides of the triangle being tangent to it. And such a circle will have a radius which is called small r. By convention, we call it as small r. Okay.
Got it, sir.
This is that small. Rajaji Nagar, I'm sure I have done this chapter to a certain extent. Tripan, do you remember? Tripan Shomik.
Oh, you did it in KVPY.
KVPY. Okay. Yeah. Some of you used to go off. Yeah. Okay. Anyways, we'll take some questions. All right. In a triangle, if tan A by 2, tan B by 2, plus tan B by 2, tan C by 2 is 2/3, then A plus C is which of the following options? Let me start the poll. Has anybody joined late? Oh, wow, Ruchir, that was fast. Okay, okay. Okay, Karthik. Okay, Anjali. Sir, you are taking our name, sir, and telling everybody that we joined late. Yes, Ruchir, absolutely correct. You are Ruchir Singh. Done. Yeah, scamming is always welcome. What, sir? You are corrupting us. Scamming is always welcome.
Sir, in mains will questions be scammable?
Ah, 10% question will definitely be scammable. And I would suggest everybody to first start scamming only. Okay, because be smart. I mean, there is no credit attached to solving a problem in a rigorous way. Scam karke, at least you'll get to know which could be your one of your answers, right? So if you do it properly, you will not be able to ever score more than 200 marks. Okay. Scamming only can make you touch 230, 220, 240s like that. Ruchir and Sukirt used to scam like anything. Not Ruchir. What is his name? Bharat and Sukirt. Huh, try the scam first. That is what I also suggest. First thing is scamming.
Many questions like matrices and all, it'll be like you can put values and
absolutely 2 seconds. When you can solve the question in 5-10 seconds by using scamming, why you need to solve it in a proper way? And knowing the way is okay, good. You have that in your armory, but don't start using that initially itself. Okay, guys, I'll stop the poll. 3 minutes already done. Option B is what people say. So most of you have gone with option B. See, since I'm teaching you this, I'll not scam here. But I'll like to recall some conditional identities for you. Some of them are very important for a triangle. So when you know that you're dealing with a triangle, however, this is true for any NPI. Okay, but you can always use it for a triangle as well. So in any triangle, tan A, tan B, tan C is nothing but tan A, tan B, tan C. This is a very important conditional identity, which is true for a case of a triangle. And one more is there, and I think there are many more, but these two are very important. So tan A by 2, tan B by 2, tan B by 2, tan C by 2, tan C by 2, tan A by 2. What is this? Can anybody tell me? This is always equal to a 1. Yes. Yeah. So this is your very important conditional identities, which you need to keep in mind. Very important conditional identities, because they're true under a condition. Now from here, these two information is already given to me as 2/3. Okay. So this has to be 1/3. Okay. So now if you know this is 1/3, you can use your tan C by 2 formula. Tan C by 2 formula will be what? S minus. Tell me, S minus A, S minus B by S, S minus C. Similarly, tan A by 2 also I'll include over here. So S minus B, S minus C by SS minus A. Okay. I believe a lot of terms will get cancelled off. This will go with this. This will go with this. And you'll have S square and S minus B. So you'll have S minus B by S equal to 1/3. Okay. So 3S minus 3B is S. So 2S is equal to 3B. Okay. 2S was A plus B plus C is equal to 3B. So if you drop a B, you end up getting the desired answer, which is A plus C is equal to 2B. Option number B is correct. Okay. You can always guess an equilateral triangle and do it in a much faster way. That is always welcome. Is it fine? Any questions here?
So you could do it without using these two identities.
Yes, yes. You can start applying the auxiliary formula right in the beginning only. Yeah, it just saved a bit of time. Absolutely correct. You can do it without using the identities as well. No problem. Yeah. All right, let's take another one. Should we take this problem? Okay, let's take this problem. In a triangle, if 2 delta square is given to be this, then which of the following is the correct option? Yes, delta means the area of the triangle. So there are certain symbols that you should be aware of. Delta is the area of the triangle. S is the semi-perimeter. Small a is the side BC. Small b is the side AC. And small c is the side AB. So these things will be uniformly used. Okay, it may require you to know one small formula, if at all it is required. ABC by 4 delta is equal to R. So your circumcircle radius, I'll speak about it officially in some time, but I think it was required in this question, or it may be required in this question. I'm not giving you a hint kind of a thing. So ABC by 4 area of the triangle is your R. It's very easy to prove. We'll prove it in some time.
Can you switch the pole now?
Sure. Yeah, it's on. Good, good. 7 of you have responded. Yeah, just I think only one option is correct, Venkat. It's a single option, correct?
Oh, okay, sir.
Okay, we'll stop the poll in another 20 seconds. Five, four, three, two, one, go. Okay, so most of you have gone with option number C. Okay, let's check. See, first of all, can I write this as A square plus B square plus C square as A square B square C square by 4 delta square? Correct? Oh, sorry, 2 delta square, not 4 delta square, 2 delta square. Okay. Now, just now we discussed that ABC by delta is equal to 4R. Correct? So ABC by delta the whole square is 16R square. So if I use it over here, I will end up getting half of 16R square, which is actually 8R square. Right? Now, A square, B square, C square, if I use my sine rule, I can easily write my left hand side like this. Okay, this will go by a factor of 2 from here. Okay, now what should I do with this? Okay, okay, let me write this in double angles of cos. So this will be cos 2a, 1 minus cos 2a by 2, 1 minus cos 2b by 2, and 1 minus cos 2c by 2. So 2 to all, I'll send it to the other side. In other words, cos 2a plus cos 2b plus cos 2c is nothing but a minus 1. Now, how many of you remember this conditional identity that cos 2a, cos 2b, cos 2c is actually 1 minus 4, minus 1 minus 4, cos a, cos b, cos c? Very important. Very important conditional identity. All the conditional identities are actually important because you never know where you require them and they will save a lot of time. So this will be minus 1 minus 4 cos A cos B cos C equal to minus 1. Minus 1 minus 1 goes off, which clearly implies that cos A cos B cos C has to be 0. Means that at least one angle here must be a 0. That means at least one angle must be a 90 degree. One of A, B and C must be 90 degrees. So what I can say with conviction that this can be a right angle triangle. Not very sure about isosceles. So please do not mark something which you're not very sure of. So you can say it is a right angle triangle, may not be isosceles. Okay. So isosceles is an extra restriction that you are putting on the system, which has not been very evident from whatever workings we have done so far. Nowhere it is evident that two of the sides have to be equal. Got it? So option number D is correct, which I think not many people, only 6 of you marked option number D. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns? All right. Next is various formulas for the area of the triangle that may be required by us. So the next concept is area of a triangle. There are so many formulas you have already learned. A few of them in your junior classes. So half base into height. Okay, half base into height. So if you have, let's say. Okay. Okay. Now, based on this, we can write several other formulas also derived from here. For example, half base, you can take it as A. Okay. Height, you can take it in several ways. For example, height you can take as C cos B. Okay. Sorry, C sin B. So it'll be C sin B. It can also be taken half into A into, this is B and this is angle C, B sin C. Okay, so two formulas already known, half AC sin B, half AB sin C. And you can also write it as half BC sin A as well. So this is already used in one of the questions which we solved today. So it says nothing but, if you have been given a triangle, right? So all you need to do know is two sides and the sandwiched angle between them. So if you know BC and A, you can get this formula. If you know BC and, sorry, this is your A, not B. So if you know AC and B, you can get this formula. And if you know A, B and C, you can get this formula. Okay. Now, using this only, we'll get one more formula, which is ABC by 4R. Area of a triangle, also known as ABC by 4R. How will I get this formula? Let's take the third one. So if you use your third formula, which is half BC sin A. Sin A, you can write it as A by 2R. Okay, so when you do that, you end up getting ABC by 4R. This is what I was discussing a little while ago when I gave you the formula delta is equal to ABC by 4R. So this is a very important relation. Okay, so this is another formula for the area of the triangle. Apart from it, you already know your Heron's formula, that is S, S minus A, S minus B, S minus C. You can prove this also from the very same fact. For example, if I want to use the, let's say, the formula half BC sin A. Okay, so sin A, you can split it up as 2 sin A by 2 cos A by 2. Okay, so this will become BC sin A formula, we all know is under root of S minus B. Sin A by 2 is S minus B, S minus C by BC. Cos A is under root of S, S minus A by BC. So in the under root, you'll have BC square, so that will come out and cancel out with the outside BC, and inside the under root you'll have S, S minus A, S minus B, S minus C. So this is how you can prove your Heron's formula as well. Okay. In due course of time, we'll see more formulas like delta is equal to small r by s. We can also write it in terms of ascribed circle radius, all those things. We'll come to those formula in some time. Okay. Please note this down because I'm going to go to the next page. Mehul, I don't know how much you have lost. In the previous page, I think we had discussed about one of the questions, I believe, right? One questions we had discussed in the previous page. So this is a theory that we are discussing on this page. So I would request you to note this down. So we have discussed around 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 formula for area of a triangle. And there are many more to come. There are many more to come.
Can you scroll up?
Yeah, sure. Done?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Let's now talk about circles connected with the triangle. circles connected with the triangle. So there'll be a lot of type of circles that we'll be talking about. Of course, the circumcircle, inner circle, the ascribed circle, etc. So let's start talking about them. We all know how to make a circumcircle, right? So if there's any triangle, okay, how do you make a circumcircle? We basically find the center of that circle by perpendicularly bisecting the sides of the triangle. Okay. And it will be concurrent at some point, and that point will be called as the circumcircle center, which we normally write it as S. Okay. So with this as your center, and you can take any one of the distance from the vertex as your radius, so they will all be equal. So SA, SB, SC, they will all be equal to RR each. Okay, you can draw a circle, and that circle is called the circumcircle. Okay, we have already discussed a lot of things. We have already discussed that your circumcircle radius is nothing but A by 2 sine A. We have also discussed that it is ABC by 4 delta. Okay. Few things that you should also remember. It is used in a lot of questions. The distance of S from the vertices and the sides. Now, from the vertices, it is no difficult work. It is all equal to R only. But from the sides, let's say I call this as PQR. PQR. Okay, so what is SP, what is SQ, and what is SR? Now, there's no need to remember this because you can easily find it out. So if you know that this angle is angle A, okay, and this side is side SB is R, you can easily get the base. Base will be nothing but R cos A, right? So SR is R cos A. SP will be similarly R cos B, and SQ will be R cos C. Okay, no need to remember, but just note it down, and you will automatically remember this through practice. There's no separate requirement for you to remember these formulae. Done. Note it down.
1 minute, sir.
Yeah. Okay. Next is this was your circumcircle. Let's talk about inner circle. Inner circle, we have a lot of things to discuss. Inner circle is basically a circle which is made by internally bisecting the angles of the triangle. So if you bisect the angle A internally, that means this angle is equal to this angle. You bisect this angle B internally. That means this angle is equal to this angle. And you bisect this angle C internally. They will all be concurrent at a point. And that point will be called as the inner center. That is denoted by the alphabet I. So what is great about the inner center? As you have found out this by internal bisector of the angles, this point is equidistant from all the three sides. So this length, and this length, they will all be equal. And hence with that as a radius, you can always sketch a circle like this. This circle, sorry for crossing this. This circle is going to have all the sides of the triangle as tangents to it. Okay. The radius of such a circle is called small r. Now, there are several formulas for finding small r. Small r, first of all, is given by delta by S. Now, what is the proof for this? Proof for this is very simple. You probably would have done this in your class 10th also. Area of a triangle will be made of area of triangle AIB, area of triangle BIC, and area of triangle CIA. Area of triangle CIA. Okay. So area of triangle AIB will be half base. Base will be C. Height is R. So half CR. Okay, let me write. Similarly, area of BIC will be half base, which is A, height is R, and again, this is half B into R. So if you take R common, it will give you this. And we all know A plus B plus C is 2S, so 2S by 2 will be S. So this is another formula that you have for the area of a triangle. You can note this down also, very important. Delta is equal to SR, or R is equal to delta by S. Okay. I'm sure you've done this type of question in your class 10th. It is there in your R.S. Agarwal book of class 10th. Couple of more formulas that we need to note down over here. So please copy this. I'll be going to the next slide. Done?
Yes.
1 minute, 1 minute.
Okay. With HSR batch, I had not done this at all, right? HSR?
So thank you, sir.
Yes.
So we only did till sine and cosine rule.
Okay. Anyways, there are a few more formulas for R. This. So all of them will give you the R expression only. So note down. I'll prove one of them. I can prove, let's say, the first one in two ways. One is by using your half angle formula. So we all know that tan A by 2. Is nothing but S minus B, S minus C by SS minus A, right? Okay. So if you apply here, this will become under root of S minus A, S minus B, S minus C by S. Multiply and divide with an S. The numerator will become delta square by S square. Okay, numerator will become delta square, denominator is S square. So this will give you delta by S, which is actually an expression for R as we had proved earlier. Okay. This is one way to prove it. Other way to prove it is a list. Yeah. Now, let's say I bisect this angle. Okay, and just let me draw this in circle in between. You should actually always draw a circle before drawing this. Anyways, I'll try to fit one inside. Maybe distorted a bit. Yeah. Anyways, so let's call this as your point of contacts, A, B, C, okay? And let's say this is your point of contact. Achha, one more thing I would like to tell you that this line that when is extended, it need not pass through where the circle is touching the BC line, okay? So this need not pass through the same point. Let me call this as P, Q, and R, okay? Now, if I call this as, let me drop a perpendicular from the center. Let's say this is your I. Okay. Now, if I call this as X, can I say this will also be X, AP and AQ? Correct? Because they are tangents from an external point to the inner circle. If I call this as Y, that is AP, BR will also be Y. Similarly, CQ is Z, CR will also be Z. Correct? In other words, 2X, 2Y, 2Z is equal to your semi-perimeter. Sorry, is equal to a perimeter. So it is twice of the semi-perimeter. So X plus Y plus Z is equal to S. Correct? Yes or no? And Y plus Z is already A. Because this length is your A. That is your side opposite to the angle A. Right? So X is nothing but S minus A. So this length is S minus A. Anyways, you should remember this result because it is required. Okay, so this is S minus A, this is also S minus A, S minus A. Similarly, this will be S minus B, S minus B, S minus C, like that. So if you focus on this triangle, triangle API, if you focus on the triangle API, you know already that this angle is half of A. So you can easily say tan of A by 2, let me write from triangle API, tan of A by 2 would be R by AP. AP is S minus A. So from here you easily get R as S minus A tan A by 2. This is another way to prove the same formula just by using pure geometry. No auxiliary formula used here. Okay, so either ways you can remember it. So all of these will give you the expressions for your in circle radius. Done, note it down. Can I go to the next formula? Any questions? Okay. The next set of formula for R is, R is given by A sine B by 2 sine C by 2 upon cos A by 2. Okay. It is also given by B sine C by 2 sine A by 2 by cos B by 2. And it is also given by C sine A by 2 sine B by 2 by cos C by 2. Okay. Can you prove this? Again, very easy to prove if you use your auxiliary formula. So if you use your auxiliary formula in any one of them, you will end up getting your desired result and each side will give you delta by S. Okay. So just prove it for homework. Prove for homework. And the most important expression for R that you should know, and it is also a relationship between capital R and small r, which is this formula. A very heavily used one. This formula is not only an expression for small r, but it also relates small r with capital R. So this gives you the relationship between the small r and the capital R. Again, you can use any one of the formula over here to prove it. For example, if you use the first one. So if you replace your A as 2R sine A, and sine A itself can be written as 2 sine A by 2 cos A by 2. So you would realize a lot of terms will start getting cancelled off. For example, cos A by 2 and cos A by 2 will go off. 2R into 2 will give you 4R and you'll end up getting the desired formula. Is this fine? All right. So from here, a very important inequality arises. So you would have all done this inequality in your trigonometry chapter, that in any triangle, sine A by 2, sine B by 2, sine C by 2 is always less than equal to 1 by 8. Okay. Equality will exist when your triangle is a equilateral triangle. So now using this condition, I can say R by 4R, because your sine A by 2, sine B by 2, sine C by 2 is R by 4R. This is less than equal to 1 by 8, which clearly means R is greater than equal to 2R. Remember, your circumcircle radius is greater than twice the encircle radius. Equality will hold when the triangle is equilateral. Is this fine? Equality holds when the triangle is equilateral. Okay. So if you see, we have taken at least four set of formulas for your small r. I think all of them are interrelated. So if you remember one of them, I think you'll be able to produce the other one in case it is required. Okay. Three of them is absolutely important. One is the one which I have shown on the screen right now. And the other one is delta by S. And S minus A tan A by 2, S minus B tan by 2, S minus C tan C by 2. This one is not that important. The one which is on the top of the screen, this is not that important. So I have not seen much use of this formula. I've seen mostly the second, the third, and the fourth one being used more frequently. Okay, we'll take up questions on this little later on. First, I would like to do ascribed circles and their radii. So let me go to the next page. Ascribed circles. So we have done circumcircle, we have done incircle. Now we'll be talking about ascribed circles because there are more than one. So what are ascribed circles? Let me just draw one for you. In fact, I should first draw a circle for you, for myself. Then I think making the side becomes, sorry. Somebody has a doubt. Oh, Venkat. Yeah, Venkat, we'll talk about it.
Sure, yeah. Sir.
So let's say ABC is my triangle. So I have purposely drawn the circle first because then it becomes convenient for me. Now, this circle is basically obtained by internally bisecting angle A. So center of the circle is obtained by internally bisecting angle A, externally bisecting angle B, and angle C. Okay, so this point is what we call as I1. Okay, I1 or IA also, many books write it. Okay, IA or I1, just to signify that it is a center of a ascribed circle opposite to the vertex A of the triangle. So this is your actual triangle. Okay, so what I did, I just internally bisected this angle, I externally bisected B and C. Okay. And I obtain a point of concurrency. And from this point, the perpendicular distance from the three sides, whether extended or not, they are all equal. So these three lengths will be all equal and they will be called as R1. Or many books will call it as RA also. Doesn't make a difference. So R1 is basically the radius of this circle, and I1, let me stick to I1 only. I1 is nothing but your center of the circle. Now, a similar thing can also be drawn had I extended BA and BC, internally bisected B, externally bisected A, externally bisected C, and drawn a circle like this. Okay. So that circle would be having a center of I2 and radius will be R2. Similarly, when I do the same thing on this side, I'll get a circle with center as I3 and radius as R3. So there can be three ascribed circles. Ascribed outside, Aditya. Inscribed means inside. There's a name given to it.
So?
Yes, Sushir.
So the extended sides are always perpendicular, like tangents.
Yes, yes, yes. This circle will have tangents as side BC. Let me write it down. Tangents would be BC. AB extended. AB extended and AC extended. Okay. So they will always be tangent. So I can say, let's say I call this as point P, Q, R. So you can say CQ is same as CP. BQ is same as BR. In fact, you can say AR is same as AP. Are you getting my point? So we'll do some geometry on this. Don't worry. So as of now, the step of construction, I'll again repeat. First, you have a triangle given to you. Correct? Extend. Let's say if you want to make an ascribed circle opposite to A. Join AB and extend it. Of course, AB is already joined. So extend AB further. Extend AC further. Okay. Internally bisect A. Externally bisect B and C. Right? So I'll write it down. Internal bisector of A and external bisector of or bisectors of B and C. So they meet at I1. So I1 is the point of concurrency of internal bisector of A and external bisector of B and C. Again, let me tell you, the perpendicular dropped from I1 to BC need not meet this internal bisector. Now, once you've got I1, the perpendicular distances of I1 from each one of these will be equal. It is because of the locus condition, right? We know that if you are bisecting the angle of a ray or of a pair of ray, any point on that bisector will be equidistant. So this point is equidistant from AB extended and AC extended. It is equidistant from BC and again AB AC extended. And it is equidistant from AB extended and BC. So this will be having equal distances from all the three sides. Okay. And that distance is called R1. By convention, we call it as R1. Now, many people ask me, sir, in the competitive exams, will they use the same kind of nomenclature? In JEE, they will define it. Because JEE, these national exams don't assume people to know all these names. Okay. But yes, certain things they will not define. They will not say A is called this and delta is called this. They will assume you to know all those things. Now, what are the values of R1, etc.? We'll figure it out. R1. The first formula that we'll talk about R1 is delta by S minus A. Okay. It is also equal to S tan A by 2. Okay. It is also equal to A cos B by 2, cos C by 2 by cos A by 2. And it is also equal to 4R sine A by 2 cos B by 2 cos C by 2. If you remember this, R2, R3 expressions will automatically come out by the trend that you will see in the formula. But before that, we'll prove it. Because you should know from where are these facts coming up. So for the first one, okay, let's prove that R1 is equal to delta by S minus A. This is very easy proof. It is done in a similar way as what we had done for finding R is equal to delta by S. That means you're dealing with the area. So the proof is, we know that area of the triangle is, just watch out this figure. Can I say it is area of AI1B plus area of AI1C minus area of BI1C. Can I say that? I would request all of you to scan this figure in your mind properly. So area of this triangle is, just watch out my white marker, area of AI1B plus area of AI1C minus area of BI1C, because BI1C is coming extra in that this thing. So I only wanted this triangle ABC area. Correct? That's why subtraction. Correct. Now, what is area of AI1B? So you know the base, you know the height. Correct? So I can say it's half CR1. So this is half CR1. Similarly, area of AI1C is, you know the base. Base is B. Height is again R1. Okay? So it's half BR1. And area of the triangle which you need to subtract, that is half base. Base is A. And perpendicular is R1. So I can say half. Let me write it in yellow. Half AR1. So if you take half R1 common, you get B plus C minus A. Okay? And B plus C minus A, you can write this as 2S minus 2A. So 2, 2 will get cancelled. So R1S minus A is equal to delta. And you should not shy away from noting this down also as one of the another formula for the area of a triangle. So delta is also given as R1S minus A. So from here, I can say R1 is delta by S minus A. Is this fine? Any questions here in the proof? See, nobody is going to ask you the proof, but see, what you learn while you're proving, that is more important. Okay. Next, how do you prove that it is S tan A by 2? Now, for that, it is very easy to prove it. I'll again explain it from this figure. See, we know that BQ length is same as BR length, right? So if I call this as X, this will also be X, correct? We know that CQ length is CP length. So if you call it as Y, this will also be Y. Am I right? Yeah. Now, AB, sorry for writing on top over here. AB plus X plus Y plus AC is equal to the perimeter of the triangle. Correct? And remember, AB plus X is AR. And AC plus Y is AP. And both are equal, by the way. Both are equal. Why both are equal? Why AP is AR? Because again, they are tangents drawn from an external point A to the ascribed circle. So if I call this as, let's say, what name should I give? ZZ. Okay. So 2Z is equal to 2S. That means Z is equal to S. That means this whole length is actually an S. Okay. So if you see, this is your A by 2, right? And this is your R1. So if you focus on your triangle, if you focus on your triangle AI1R, AI1R, can I say tan A by 2 can be written as R1 by S? And from here we get another formula, which is what you wanted to prove. S is equal to, sorry, R1 is equal to S tan A by 2. So this formula is proven. Is that fine?
Yes, sir.
Any questions, do let me know.
So could you scroll to the right?
Here?
Yes, that's it.
Let me know once you're done so that we can move on. Okay, so rest of the formula, I think you can easily prove by using your, you know, basic conversion, basic auxiliary formula. So I'm not going into details of that. But yes, I will definitely write R2 and R3 expression similarly so that you know what is this, you know, analogous expression for R1, R2, R3. So let me do a comparison chart here. So a very summary of your ascribed and the inscribed circle radius. See, we already have seen small r is delta by s. Okay. It is s minus a tan a by 2. It is s minus b tan b by 2. And I'm just writing the important ones, the ones which will be very, very useful for you. 4 sine a by 2, sine b by 2, sine c by 2. Correct? In the same way, R1, the small change that will happen from this formula, instead of S, you will have S minus A. Instead of S minus A, you will have an S. Okay. Rest formula I will not copy. Oh, by the way, here is one more formula I can write. S minus C tan A by 2. And in this formula, what will happen? Only sine A by 2 will remain. Rest all will get converted to cos. Less both will get converted to cos. Okay. R2, you can easily predict from here. R2 will be what? Tell me. Delta by S minus B.
Minus B.
Yeah. And it will be S tan B by 2. Correct. And what will happen here? This one will become sine B by 2. Rest both will be cos. So this is what I said. If you remember one, you will be able to produce the other one in the exam very easily. Is this fine? Any questions? Now, what is more important is to know the relationship between these small r's. So how is small r1, small r2, small r3 connected? This is more important for us because you know, many questions will be directly based on that. However, I will give you few of them and we'll derive also few of them. So the process of derivation should be known to all of us. Okay, I will not be able to take up all the questions. Okay. So let us start with this particular formula, and this is very important. The formula is 1 by R1, 1 by R2, 1 by R3 is equal to, plus 1 by r square is equal to a square plus b square plus c square by s square. I should write delta square. Okay. R1, R2, R3 is delta square. There are a lot of properties. I can just give you a few of them. This is S square. Okay. One of them is very important. R1 plus R2 plus R3 minus R is equal to 4R. This is very important. There are actually tons of formula which relate your small r to capital R. Meanwhile, can you try proving one of them? Let's say try proving third.
So you just write it as f tan a by 2, and then we know tan a by 2 tan b by 2 plus tan b by 2 tan a. That's 1.
Okay.
And s square you can pull out common. So s square okay. into 1 is s square.
Is that clear? Everybody please try. Done. Couple of more we can add here. Cos A, cos B, cos C is 1 plus R by R. Okay. A cos A, B cos B, C cos C by A plus B plus C. A plus B plus C is equal to small r by capital R. There are many actually, there are many. I mean, I cannot give you all of them. But yes, we should know how to tackle these proofs. Okay, these proofs are very important. One I wanted to give it in the beginning. I think I changed my mind when I was giving it. So this one. Okay, so you don't have to remember them, but you should know how to, deal with them, how to prove them. Now, which one we were trying to prove? The third one, right? Right. So how do you prove the third one? So if you know this formula, and if you know the last one, we can prove it very easily. So if I able to prove this one first, so R1, R2, R3. R1, R2, R3, we all know it's delta by S minus A, delta by S minus B, delta by S minus C. Correct? So it's delta cube by S minus A, S minus B, S minus C. Correct? Oh, once again, I think I missed out an R over there. Sorry. So delta by S. Delta by S, yeah. So this will become delta to the power 4, and this itself is the Heron's formula delta square. Okay. So if you're able to see this, then you are able to also figure out that R1, R2, R3 is delta square by R. Correct? Okay. And here, in the left hand side, let me write it down over here. In the left hand side, if I take R1, R2, R3 common, I get 1 by R1, 1 by R2, 1 by R3. Okay. This is already delta square by R. And this is actually 1 by R. So it's delta square by R square. And delta square by R square is known as the square of the semi-perimeter, because small delta is small r into small s. Okay. So they're all very interlinked. So this you can find it in any standard book. Okay. So try practicing a few of these questions. Meanwhile, I'll take some direct questions which can be based on these particular properties. So let's take a few questions on them. scroll down. Yeah. Here, this side. Sure. Let's say this question we want to do. In a triangle, small r1 plus r2 plus r3 is 9r. Then the triangle is necessarily which of the following? Then the triangle is necessarily which of the following? Poll is on. Very good, Ruchir. Good, good. Good speed. Normally in the crash course and all, the speed is very good. I mean, roughly students will take around 1 minute 15 seconds to somewhere around 1 minute 45 seconds to solve questions. But we have to come to that speed. Awesome. All of you have voted for the same option. Good. I think the first thing that everybody tries is taking an equilateral triangle. So B option is most obvious for many of them. Okay, end of poll, we'll check which option is correct. Most of you have, in fact, all of you have voted for option B. See, if you know the formula R1 plus R2 plus R3 minus R is equal to 4R, which is one of the well-known formulae, you can automatically say this is 4R plus R. And as per the question, this is 9R. That means 4R is equal to 8R. That means R is equal to 2R. Little while ago, I had discussed that equality between R and 2R will exist when the triangle is equilateral. So that further proves that option number B is the right option. Okay, you may have your own way of doing it. Not an issue. Easy. Next. In triangle ABC, small r is capital R by 6 and R1 is 7R. Find the measure of the angle A. Should I put the poll? All right, so let the poll be on. Let the poll be on. Okay, good. I've got few responses.
So give me one more minute.
Yeah, take your time. Nice. Three of you have responded and all of you have voted for the same option. So chances that it's correct is good enough, high enough. Okay, let's discuss. Enough time. Let's close this in another 20 seconds. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Okay, so most of you have voted for D. D for Delhi. Let's check. See, first of all, let's do R minus R1, or let's say R1 minus R. R1, we all know, it's 4R sine A by 2, cos B by 2, cos C by 2. And small r is 4R sine A by 2, sine B by 2, sine C by 2. Correct? If you take 4R sine A by 2 common, you'll end up getting cos B by 2 cos C by 2 minus sine B by 2 sine C by 2, which is conveniently written as cos of B plus C by 2. Am I right? Now we know that we are dealing with a triangle. So B plus C by 2 is pi by 2 minus A by 2. So cos of B plus C by 2 is actually sine of A by 2. So this reduces to 4R sine square A by 2. Now, again, this result I wanted to share with you, but I thought, you know, let not everything be shared because you'll not be able to remember it. But yes, you should know how to work around this. This really makes your life very easy in solving this question because you know your small r1 is 7 small r, or your r1 is 7r. So this is small r minus r, which is actually your 6r, and 6r is your capital R. Okay. In other words, sine square A by 2 is equal to 1/4. That means sine of A by 2 is half. That means A by 2 is 30 degrees. So A has to be 60 degrees. Option number D is correct. Is that clear? Any questions? Any questions on this? Okay. We'll take one more before we start a new. Yeah, let's take this one. If ABC is a right angle triangle at A, cos inverse capital R by R2 plus R3, where capital R, R2, R3 mean the normal things that we have discussed so far, this is equal to which of the following options? Poll is on. Good. 1 minute gone. Two people responded so far. Okay, we'll stop it in count of 5, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Cool. All right. Most of you have gone with option number B. Let's check. See, again, there's a lot of hint given to us in the question. Let's find R2, R3. R2, as we all know, is 4R cos A by 2, sin B by 2, cos C by 2. And R3 is 4R cos A by 2, cos B by 2, sin C by 2. Okay. If you take 4R cos A by 2 common, okay, you will end up getting sin B by 2, cos C by 2, and cos B by 2, sin C by 2, which is clearly sin B plus C by 2. Okay. Since we're dealing with a triangle, we can all say that, we can all say that sin B plus C by 2 is actually cos A by 2. Right? Isn't it? So R2 plus R3 is this. So clearly, the expression within the cos inverse, which is R by R2 plus R3, is actually 4 cos square A by 2. Am I correct? Yes. And A is 90 degrees. So A by 2 is 45 degrees. So it's 1 by 4, 1 by root 2 square. So it's actually 1 by 4 into half, which is actually 1 by 2. So cos inverse of this is as good as doing cos inverse of half, and cos inverse of half is pi by 3. Option number C. Is that fine? Okay. Now, a couple of things that we would like to link up to whatever we have done so far. Number one is the length of the median. Okay, this is very important. Length of the median of a triangle. So let me just make a triangle quickly. Okay, so length of median coming from vertex A. Okay. Does anybody remember this formula? We had done this. I think Yashwantpur will remember it. Anybody from Yashwantpur?
Length of median.
Length of a median coming from vertex A.
No, sir.
Are you? Sure. Okay. It's half under root of 2b square 2c square minus a square. This is your, let's say I call it as AM. Okay, can you prove this quickly? Let's say even if you don't remember it. Can you prove this? Can anybody prove this? Hint, use cosine law. Use cosine law, you'll be able to prove it. Anybody? Okay. Let's say AM is X. Okay, this is A by 2, correct? Focus on this angle B. Okay. If I write a cosine rule for B, what will I write? A square plus C square minus B square by 2AC. Am I right? Correct?
So you're doing cosine for ABM, sir?
I'm doing cosine for the whole triangle.
Oh, okay, sir. Okay.
And I will also do it for ABM. Correct? So ABM, if I write it, it will be A by 2 square. By the way, this side is C. C square minus X square by AC. Correct? And both of them basically will give you the same value because they are cos of the same angles. So if you compare 1 with 2, what do you get? You get A square plus C square minus B square by 2AC is equal to A square by 4 plus C square minus X square by AC. AC, AC gone. And if I multiply with the 2, I'll get A square plus C square minus B square as A square by 2 plus 2C square minus 2X square. Correct? So 2x square is nothing but c square plus b square minus a square by 2. That means 2x square is equal to 2b square 2c square minus a square by 2. If you bring this 2 down, it will become a 4. And if you take the square root of it, this is what you're going to see. Square 4 will come out and it will become 2 times 2b square 2c square minus a square. Okay, this result should be kept in mind. Bahut use hota hai. So just keep this in mind. It's half of under root 2b square 2c square minus a square. That is the length of the median coming from the vertex A. In a similar way, if I ask you what is the length of the median coming from vertex B and C respectively, I'm sure you'll be able to figure that out also. Let's say I call it as N and let's say I call this as P. So what is BN then? Take a clue from this. Tell me the other word, median BN. So half, this will be 2A square, 2C square minus B square. And the other median CP, I hope I've called it CP only. Yeah, CP would be half under root of 2a square 2b square minus c square. So these three length of the median are very important. So you know how it is derived and you should just note down the formula. Similarly, we'll derive the length of the internal angle bisectors also. Done, note it down. Can I go to the next page? So could you go down? Derivation part, Dhyan?
This yes, part? Sir.
Okay. Good enough?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you.
Inequalities is already there in your trigonometric inequations. Aditya, to answer your question, you should go for trigonometric inequations. I don't know which book you are following, but that is a very explicit chapter for you in Arihant. If you follow Amit Agarwal's Arihant, they have given as a separate chapter trigonometric inequalities.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So length of angle bisectors. Okay, so let's say if you bisect the angle, internal angle of A, Okay, let me call this as AP. Okay, please note that AP length is given as 2BC by B plus C cos A by 2. Now, I can give you other formulas also, but let me derive this first of all. So the derivation part of it is very simple. Just drop a perpendicular. Just drop a perpendicular from these vertices on this. Okay. So let's say I call this as an X. Now we all know that area of a triangle is half BC sine A. Okay. So let's say A angle is known and this is your A by 2, A by 2. Okay. And it is also equal to area of the triangle ABP plus area of the triangle APC. Okay. Now since this is 90 degree and this is A by 2. Okay. And we know these side lengths. Okay. What is the perpendicular here? Base is X only. What is the perpendicular height over here? It may not be a very accurate diagram. So perpendicular will be B sine A by 2. Okay. Similarly, for the other also, this will be C sine A by 2. Okay. Now, sine A here, I can break it up as sine A by 2 cos A by 2. Half gone. Sine A by 2, sine A by 2, sine A by 2 gone. So you'll end up getting XB plus C is equal to BC cos, in fact, 2BC cos A by 2. So from here, X can be figured out as 2BC by B plus C cos A by 2. This is a very, very important formula. You must remember it. Okay. This is the length of your internal angle bisector coming from A. Okay. Similarly, let's say if I make an internal angle bisector coming from B as BQ and internal angle bisector coming from C as CR. So BQ will be, take a clue from this and tell me what should be BQ. 2AC A plus C cos B by 2. Okay. And CR will be 2AB by A plus B cos of C by 2. So just like you noted down the formula for your medians, please note down the length of the angle bisectors. Is it fine? Any questions? Okay. Next is your MN theorem. MN theorem. Not very important. Basically, it comes from your sine rule only. So MN theorem is basically a formula which links the following. I'll just write it down over here. Let's say this is your triangle ABC. Okay. And let's say there is a point on this side D, let's say. Okay. And I connect it to A. Okay. Says that this angle is theta. This angle is alpha. This angle is beta. And D divides BD into DC in the ratio of M is to N. Okay. Then there's a relationship which connects all these things that you see over here. M, N, alpha, beta, and theta. And that relation is M plus N cot theta is m cot alpha minus n cot beta. Okay, there's one more version of it. Basically, they say the same thing. M plus n cot theta is n cot b. B is the angle of the triangle minus m cot c. Let's try to prove the first one. Second one will automatically come from there. So everybody, please try to prove the first one. This may come as a direct question. After doing this, we can take a small break. On the other side of the break, I'll talk about the pedal triangle and how pedal triangle is related to the eccentric triangle. All those things we'll take up. We'll also have to talk about the concept of distance between the critical points. We'll also have to talk about the concept of quadrilaterals, cyclic quadrilateral, and solution of triangles. So we have a lot of grounds to cover. In fact, I should start doing this. If you look at ABD, okay, apply sine rule there. So can I say BD by sine alpha is equal to AD by this angle. Now, what is this angle? This angle, I can write it as theta minus alpha. Correct? Because theta is the sum of the two interior angles over here, right? So if this is theta, this is alpha, this has to be theta minus alpha. Very good, Richard. Very good. Okay. So let me call this as one of the equations. Similarly, if I apply sine rule on triangle ADC, can I say DC by sine of beta is equal to AD by now AD by this angle. What is this angle? This angle will be, okay, this is 180 minus theta, right? So can I say this angle is pi minus theta minus beta? So it is sine of theta plus beta, because sine pi minus something is sine of the same angle. Is this clear that this is pi minus theta and this is an external angle? So these two sums should be equal to this external angle. Correct? Yes or no? Let me call this as second equation. Now take the ratio. So BD by sine alpha okay, correct. Now BD by DC is already given to us as m is to n. So m is to n sine beta sine alpha will be equal to this. You can expand sine theta cos beta cos theta sine beta by sine theta cos alpha minus sine alpha cos theta, cross multiply. Just a second. Yeah, sorry. Yeah, so cross multiply. So if you cross multiply, you get m sine beta sine theta cos alpha. We can also write it as m sine beta sine alpha cos theta equal to n sine alpha sine theta cos beta plus n sine alpha cos theta sine beta. Okay, let's remove this bracket, unnecessary bracket. Now let's do one thing. Let's divide both sides. Let's divide both the sides. Divide both sides by sine alpha, sine beta, and sine theta. Okay, so let's divide throughout with sine alpha, sine beta, sine theta. So what will happen to this term? This term will become m cot alpha. Correct? What will happen to this term? This will become m cot theta. What will happen to this term? This will become n cot beta. And this will become again n cot theta. Okay. So let us bring your theta terms to one side. So m plus n. So I'm bringing this term to this side and this term to this side. So m plus n cot theta will be m cot alpha minus n cot beta. This is called the MN rule. I have not seen many questions on this in JE. But yes, this is a very favorite topic of Olympiad people. So people who write RMO, PRMO. Okay. So please try to prove the other one similarly. That's very easy. It can be proved from in a similar way. Okay. So this is called the MN theorem. This is called the MN theorem. Okay. Let's have a break right now. Because on the other side of the break, we'll talk about a new concept. I don't want to take that concept right now. It'll take at least 15, 20 minutes. So next concept that we are going to talk about is the pedal triangle. Pedal triangle. Okay. So what is this triangle? This triangle is basically obtained by connecting the feet of the altitudes drawn onto the sides of the triangle from the opposite vertex. So let me just draw a triangle for you. Okay. So if I start dropping perpendiculars, from the opposite vertices onto the opposite side. So they are all perpendiculars. Okay. And the triangle which I connect by joining these feet. Okay. So let's say this is A, B, C, and this is D, E, F. Okay. So this triangle is basically called as the pedal triangle. The one which you see in the blue color. Okay. Now, there are certain things that we need to understand about pedal triangle. Number one, what is the side length of the pedal triangle? What is the angle of this triangle? For example, what is angle D, what is angle E, and what is angle F, etc. So we need to understand that thing. We need to also understand what is the circumcircle radius of this triangle, right? So let's try to discuss that. First thing first, what is the side length of this pedal triangle? Let's try to figure that out. Yeah, so let's try to prove the following. Okay, let's try to find out EF length. Let's try to find out FD length. And let's try to find out DE length. Okay. EF length is given by A cos A. A is the length of BC. And angle A is the normal angle of the triangle ABC. FD is given as B cos B. And DE is given as C cos C. Okay. Now, how do we prove this? How do we find out these lengths? The proof for this is very simple. If you focus on this triangle, small triangle AFE, what do you think is the length of AE? It's very simple since this is 90 degree and this is angle A. Okay. Then this angle has to be 90 degree minus A. Am I right? Correct? So this length that is AE is like the opposite. This is your hypotenuse. This is your perpendicular. So I'll just draw this diagram again. So this will be something like this. So this is going to be 90 minus A. Okay. And this side length is C. We have to find AE length. AE is this length. Okay. So I'm just drawing the same structure over here. Okay. So tell me, what is AE length? If this is C and this is 90 minus A, it's very obvious that this length will be C cos A. Correct? So this is C cos A. What will be this length? AF length. Can I say AF length will be B cos A? Am I right? Now,
yes, sir.
Now let us use our cosine formula on AEF. Cosine rule on triangle AEF. So let's say I call this as X for the time being. So can I say B cos A square C cos A square minus X square by 2 B C cos square A is equal to cos A itself? Is it fine? Have I written everything correctly? Just confirm this. Correct? So I can say X square is nothing but B square plus C square cos square A minus 2 BC cos cube A. Am I correct? Okay. Now here, if you see, if you take cos square A, you will end up getting B square plus C square minus 2BC cos A. What is this formula actually? This formula is actually a cosine rule which gives you A square, isn't it? So what we end up getting is X value, which is A cos A. This is to be kept in mind. You will not sit and derive the pedal triangle length every time. So this length is A cos A. In the same way, you can prove that this is B cos B and this is C cos C. So these are the lengths of the pedal triangle.
So how did we construct the pedal triangle?
Yeah. Foot of the perpendicular we combined. No, that is the first thing I said. What, your internet went blank that time?
No, sir, I just came back.
Drop perpendiculars from your vertices onto the opposite side. Connect the feet of the perpendicular. That triangle is called the pedal triangle. Okay. Now, how do I find these angles? How do I find these angles? Angle FDE.
So I have one more doubt.
Yes. Tell me.
So if the angle is like obtuse, then when you drop a perpendicular, won't it come outside?
Yeah. See, we draw it for an acute angle triangle.
Okay.
So we are making this pedal triangle. That's a very good thing that you pointed out. So we are making this for an acute angle triangle. Okay. In this case, we are making it for the acute angle triangle. However, in reality, your pedal triangle can be drawn for any triangle. In this case, in the figure, I have drawn an acute angle triangle just to make it clear to you. Because if you have a different kind of a triangle, and if you are looking at an acute angle, obtuse angle triangle, some of these angles may be more than 90 degree. And in that case, your length of the sides will become a negative. Okay. So we are assuming that our triangle drawn here is an petal triangle. There is something called orthic triangle. That's a similar concept. Okay. Normally orthic triangle and petal triangle are basically, you know, interchanged, but they are not actually. Okay. We'll not talk about orthic triangle. That's not a part of our syllabus. However, this is also not that important, but indirect questions can be framed on it. That's why we are discussing it out. Okay. Now, next is the angle of this petal triangle. The angle of this petal triangle is basically, let me write it down here. I'll erase this part.
Sir?
Yes, sir, Tripan.
So for obtuse triangles also, petal triangle is defined, but not in this way.
Not in this
way. I mean, the sidelines are not like this.
Yes.
Okay.
So petal triangle angles, let me just remove this. Yeah. So angle FDE is pi minus 2a. Angle DEF is pi minus 2b, and angle EFD is pi minus 2c. So these are your angles of the petal triangle. Now, how do I find that out? How do I find that out? Now, one thing you have to understand here is that in the petal triangle, the orthocenter point, which is your H point, is actually the incenter of the petal triangle. Very important, note it down. Orthocenter of triangle ABC is your incenter of your petal triangle, which is triangle DEF. That means this angle is bisected here, this angle is bisected here, and this angle is bisected here. Okay. Now let us try to figure out from this information what should be your angle FDE. Now if you see very closely, this is 90 degrees and this is 90 degrees. That means triangle HFBD. I hope you can see the figure. Quadrilateral HFBD, that would become a cyclic quadrilateral. That means you can always pass a circle through these four points. Because in a cyclic quadrilateral, the property is the opposite vertices are supplementary. So which is happening in this case? So this angle and this angle adds up to 180 degrees. So it can be considered to be a cyclic quadrilateral. If it is a cyclic quadrilateral, you can all see that this is your one of the, you can say, segments on the circle. And this angle, which is your 90 minus A, is lying on this segment, correct? So as per the circle property, this angle and this angle should be the same because they are angles lying on the same arc, correct? So if this is 90 minus A, this should also be 90 minus A. And just now we said that this is a in center. So this is basically an internal angle bisector. So you can say this also is 90 minus A. So 90 minus A, 90 minus A, the total angle will become 180 minus 2A. And that's how you end up getting this angle. Okay. Similarly, you can prove the other two as well. So these two things should be kept in mind, that the sides of a petal triangle is given by this and the angle is given by this. One pi minus 2a, pi minus 2b, pi minus 2c. Now, what about the circumcircle of a petal triangle? Let's say that is given to you as a question. How is the circumcircle of the petal triangle related to the circumcircle of ABC? So if I draw a circle, let me draw a fresh diagram. This is all cluttered up. Let me go to the, sorry. Oh my God, what is all these opening in my system? Okay, let me go to the pedal triangle diagram once again. Okay, so this was our pedal triangle. If you draw a circle which circumscribes the pedal triangle, I mean, my circle is not that good. Let me just make it from a tool. Yeah, so let's say this circle has a radius of r dash, and thus the circumcircle radius of ABC is r. Note that r dash is r by 2. Now, how? Very easy to prove it. See, in any triangle, this condition, which is your sine rule, will be satisfied, right? So for this triangle also, can I say 2r dash will be A. Now, what is A for this? A for this is EF or FE, whatever you have written earlier also, FE, by sine of the angle opposite to it. This is nothing but pi minus 2a, right? So if you start writing this in terms of your capital A and small a, this is what you end up writing, correct? And this is nothing but a sine a, sorry, a cos a by 2 sine a cos a, right? So cancel this off. Now we know that a by 2 sine a is capital R. So you can say that 2 r dash is equal to r. So your r dash is equal to r by 2. So this is an important result, which says that the circumcircle radius of the pedal triangle is half the radius of the circumcircle of the original triangle. Okay. Now, one interesting thing that I would like to share with you is, do you remember we had discussed about the ascribed circles? Okay. So let me show you something very interesting. So let us say this triangle is made by connecting the ascribed circles center, I1, I2, I3. I hope you remember I1, I2, I3 were the centers of the ascribed circle. Please be aware that the ascribed circle's pedal triangle is your original triangle ABC. That means if I drop a perpendicular, on the pedal triangle and start connecting the bases or start connecting the feet of the altitudes, then this will be your original triangle ABC. Are you getting my point? The original triangle ABC, whose ascribed circle had centers I1, I2, I3. Okay. So I1, I2, I3's pedal triangle is ABC. So let me write it down. Triangle ABC is the pedal triangle for triangle I1, I2, I3. It's a very interesting fact. This triangle is known as the X-central triangle. This triangle is known as the X-central triangle. That means the in-center of ABC will be orthocenter of I1, I2, I3. So that also I will write it down. That is the incenter of triangle ABC is the orthocenter of triangle I1, I2, I3. Okay. Now, on the basis of this known fact, I have a question to all of you. Can you give me the length of the sides of the X-central triangle? What is I1, I2? What is I2, I3? And what is I1, I3, I1? Can you give me in terms of the dimensions of ABC? Assuming that this is your normal A, okay, this is your B, this is your C, this is your B, okay, and you know all your angles also. This is angle A, this is angle B, this is angle C. Can you give me I1, I2, I3 in terms of the dimensions of ABC as you can see on the screen? How will you give me I1, I2 length? Okay, it's very simple. Now, if you try to write this length, AB, correct? Can I say it is I1, I2 cos of angle A, correct? Which is this angle? Am I right?
Yes.
Yes or no? I1, I2 cos of this angle. Now, how much is this angle? Can somebody tell me?
Pi minus C. Pi minus 2C.
Okay, let's say I call this theta for the time being. Right. Can I say this angle, which is angle C, is actually supposed to be pi minus 2 theta? Am I right? Am I correct?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So 2 theta is going to be pi minus c. So theta is going to be pi by 2 minus c by 2. Okay. So that also gave me an opportunity to know these angles of the X central triangle. So this is pi by 2 minus c by 2. Okay. Similarly, can I say this angle will be pi by 2 minus a by 2? And this angle will be pi by 2 minus b by 2. Okay. Now, having known this, let us complete our pending work. Okay. So I1, I2 cos pi by 2 minus c by 2 is actually your side length small c. Am I right? Correct? Yes or no?
Oh, yes, sir.
Correct. So I1, I2 would be nothing but C by sine C by 2. Correct? Yes or no? Now, normally this C, we write it as 2R sine C by sine C by 2. Okay. So when you expand it, when you break it in half angles, it becomes 4R sine C by 2 cos C by 2. Divided by sine c by 2. This will get cancelled and you will get the length of the parallel triangle as 4r. You can write this also, not an issue, but let us write it as 4r cos c by 2. So this is your length of I1, I2. This is your length of I1, I2. Okay. So I1, I2 is 4r cos c by 2. So can you take a clue from this and tell me what is I2, I3? 4R
cos A by 2.
Cos A by 2. And this will be 4R cos B by 2. Is that fine? Any questions with respect to this derivation?
Sir, I had a doubt on why the orthocenter of the outer triangle is the incenter of the parallel triangle.
Okay, this is a very beautiful question you asked, and I'll give this as a proof for all of you to figure out. Why is the in center of the parallel triangle is the ortho center of the you can say the original outside triangle, or for that matter here, why is the in center of ABC ortho center of the x-central triangle I1, I2, I3? Okay, it's a very simple thing. You just figure it out. It's not going to take much of a time. You have to make three cyclic quadrilaterals. In fact, four will be formed. So one cyclic will be this guy. Other cyclic will be the one which I already used, this guy. Other will be this guy. Okay. So from there, you can figure out very easily, Tripan. So I'm giving you as a hint. Try to figure it out. You have to make cyclic quadrilaterals to figure that out. You'll automatically realize that this angle, what you get for the this part, the same thing you'll get for this part also. Okay. Automatically, you'll come to know from there. Don't worry about it.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes, Shaumik.
So, we can simply say that the line A, I1 is the bisecting angle A, and similarly I3 is bisecting angle C. So that point of intersection is basically the point of intersection of all the angle bisectors. So it's the in center.
No, it is by the construction actually that I have already incorporated it. But his question is more, you can say, more basic. Why is it happening like that? He's asking. He's asking, why is the internal angle bisector of ABC meeting at the same point as the altitudes drawn from I1, I2, I3?
Okay, sir. Okay.
That is his question, actually. Got the point?
Yes. Okay.
So, did you get my approach here? See, I'll give you an idea about it. See, this angle is how much? What is this angle? Let's say this angle was I1 angle. Can I say this angle is 90 degree minus I1? Right? No?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Can I say this angle will also be 90 degree minus I1 because there can be a cyclic quadrilateral fitted over here?
Yes, sir.
Similarly, this angle is also 90 degree minus I1. Correct? And yes, this sir, angle yes, is equal sir. To this because you can fit a cyclic quadrilateral like this. Correct?
Yes, sir. Gosh.
This is what I wanted you to figure it out, but okay, fine. Now I've given it out, so it's fine. So that's why this angle and this angle become same, this angle and this angle become same, and this angle and this angle become same, and hence it is along the internal angle bisector, and hence this point is the in center of ABC, which is also the coinciding point of the altitudes of the x central triangle. Okay.
Got it, sir.
Is this fine? All right. Okay, now my question to you is, can we find a relationship between the circumcircle radius of the x-central triangle and the circumcircle radius of ABC? I'll say, come on, sir, 2R. Is that fine? It is basically dependent on the previous question that I had asked you, where the pedal triangle circumcircle radius was half the circumcircle radius of this. So if this guy has a circumcircle radius of R, X central triangle will have a circumcircle radius of 2R. Okay. So both are interlinked. So both our concepts are interlinked. So just keep this in mind. It may help you in solving, you know, some questions. Now comes the critical distances between let's talk about some important distances. Okay. So the first thing that I would like you to tell me in center. We know all that in center is obtained by internally bisecting these angles. Okay. Right. What is AI, BI, and CI length? Okay. What is the, what are these lengths? It is very important to know these lengths because they will be very much used in finding you know, a lot of other important distances, which we'll take up later in this chapter. So what is AI, BI, and CI? Who will tell me? So you'll say simple. If I drop a perpendicular from I, let me just use a If I drop a perpendicular from I onto the side AB, this is going to be R. Okay. And you already know this is A by 2. So can I say AI will be the hypotenuse of this triangle? Let me name it as M. So AMI, hypotenuse is AI. Correct. So R by AI is sine A by 2. So AI is R by sine A by 2. So please keep this in mind. A very important result, which can further be written as 4R sine B by 2 sine C by 2. Now don't ask me why, because your small r can be written as 4R sine A by 2 sine B by 2 sine C by 2. So sine A by 2 will get cancelled off. So this is your AI. Similarly, BI will be R by sine B by 2, or it can be written as 4R sine A by 2 sine C by 2. And CI can be written as R by sine C by 2, which is 4R sine A by 2 sine B by 2. Okay. Now it is needless to talk about the distance from the sides because you know it's all R. So we will not talk about it. Next, it is important to know the same thing for the ortho center as well. So let me. So ortho center, we all know, is obtained by the altitudes. Okay. And we normally write ortho center as H. So who will tell me AH, BH, and CH distances? Also, let us call it as PQR. Let us also figure out HP, HQ, HR. Okay, so for finding AH, can I say this angle is 90 minus C? Because this is 90 and this whole angle is C. So this is 90 minus C. Am I right? Okay. Second thing that I can say is that this whole length is actually a small c, isn't it? This whole length is actually a small c. And this angle is 90 minus A. Correct? Because this is whole thing is A and this is 90 degrees. So this angle is 90 minus A. So now you have a right angle triangle ABQ. This angle is 90 minus A, this is C. So this can be written as C cos A. Correct me if I'm wrong. AQ can be written as C cos A. Am I right? Correct me if I'm wrong. Now, this angle is 90 degree minus C and AH is known. AH is unknown to me. So let us find that out. So can I say C cos A by AH will be cos of 90 minus C, right? Which is actually sine C. So C cos A by sine C is equal to AH. And C by sine C is 2R. A very important result. If you remember in one of our vector question, we had used this result and many of you did not know about it. Okay, now you know this result. Yes, Uchir, 2R cos A. Yes, sir.
So I have a different method.
There can be so many methods. Yes, you can share with us.
Like we can find AP because we know the angle and we know the length.
Okay.
And then we can subtract the radius of the in center. The A cos A.
No. That you're saying HP is the in center radius.
Yes.
No. It is not. कोई भी परपेंडिकुलर आपका इन सर्कल रेडियस थोड़ी बन जाएगा. इट इज नॉट इन सर्कल रेडियस. ओके. सिमिलरली BH, कैन आई से फ्रॉम द सेम थिंग BH विल बी 2R cos B एंड CH विल बी 2R cos A cos C. दिस रिजल्ट इज आई हैव फेल्ट इट इज वेरी कॉमनली यूज्ड, सो बेटर टू कीप इट इन माइंड. ओके. Now from the same thing, I can also get the HQ, HP and HR also. So HQ, if I just look at the diagram again, AHQ triangle, HQ will be what? So HQ by C cos A will be tan of 90 degree minus C. HQ by C cos A is tan of this angle, which is cot C. So HQ will be C cos A cot C. Okay, right now C by sine C again will become a 2R, so you can say it is 2R cos A cos C. So HQ length is 2R cos A cos C. Can you take a clue from this and tell me the others? Oh, sorry, I wrote it against the wrong one. HQ 2R cos A cos C. Now remember, HQ was the one which is opposite to your vertex B. So that's why there was no B. HP is the one opposite to A. So there will be no A there. So it will be 2R cos B cos C. And HR will be similarly 2R cos A cos B. Is that fine? You could have also multiplied. You could also use this length also for getting your HQ, HP and HR, etc. This is not very important. No need to remember. Not very important. Not important, I should write. But these are important because they are used. I've seen many problems which directly require you to use these results. Okay. So far, what have we covered? We have already covered how far is your I from A, B, C? How far is your I from the sides? How far is your H from A, B, C? How far is your H from the sides? And we have already done it for the case of circumcircle center also. How far it is from the vertex RRR and how far it is from the sides, which was R cos A, etc. R cos A, R cos B, R cos C, etc. So we are done with the critical distances. Now using this, we'll be talking about few more distances. So let's move on to the next slide. All of you have copied this. Everybody has copied this. Can I move on to the next page?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Okay. All right, so next thing that we are going to talk about is the distance between distance between the circumcenter and the incenter. Number one, circumcenter and incenter. Okay. Now, this length is given to us. Let me call this as S. Let me call this as I symbolically. So the distance between S and I is given by the simpler formula to remember is R square minus 2RR. And a complicated version of it is both are same thing only. Okay. We will prove we'll derive one of these distances, because I'll be also talking about distance between ortho center and the circumcenter, etc., etc. So let us first derive one of them. You'll get an idea about how we can use it, how we can use this to find out the other proofs also. So let me draw a diagram for the same. Let me draw a diagram. Okay, let's say I draw a diagram like this. Now we know that S is obtained by perpendicularly bisecting the sides. It is a very, very obtuse case. So I'll take another triangle. Yeah. This is your S. Okay. And I also, let me draw. Okay, I'm just showing two of the internal angle bisectors. This is your I point. Okay, so how do you find out this length? Let's say SI. How do you find SI length?
Do they lie along the same line passing through the opposite side?
Are you saying A, I, and S lie on the same line? Needn't be.
Okay, sir.
Need not be. Yes. Any idea how to deal with this?
Sir, no coordinates are given, no, sir.
Nothing.
Okay, sir.
Okay. I'll give you a hint. If you look at the triangle ASI, AS is R. Okay. And what is AI?
R by sine A by 2.
Correct. Okay. Can I somehow figure this small thin angle? Can I figure that out? Can I figure that out? This thin angle in between, what is this angle? See, very simple. This angle would have been angle C, right? So if you drop a perpendicular from the circumcenter on here, actually this whole thing is 2C, right? So can I say this is C? This is also C, correct? So this is C and this is 90 degree. What is this angle going to be? 90 minus C, right? This angle is already A by 2. Correct? So what is this thin angle? So thin angle will say
A minus 90 minus C.
A by 2 minus 90 minus C. Correct? Now A by 2 minus 90 plus C. Now 90 I will write it as minus A by 2 minus B by 2 minus C by 2. Can I say it becomes just C minus or C by 2 minus B by 2? Correct? No? Correct?
Yes, sir.
Can I write cosine law for this thin triangle ACI? Oh, sorry, ASI. ASI, not CI. ASI. This looked like a C to me. Yeah. So let's write the cosine law for the triangle ASI. So cos of C by 2 minus B by 2 will be what? Can I say this will be AI square? Okay. AI square, correct? Plus R square minus X square by 2 into. Achha, by the way, I can use my direct formula also here. R is known to be 4R sine A by 2 sine B by 2 sine C by 2. So let me use that only. So that will be 4R sine B by 2 sine C by 2 square. Okay. So this will become 2 into 4R sine B by 2 sine C by 2 into R. So R square. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns here?
Just a second, sir. So could you scroll up a bit?
Here?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Done, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. So from here, can I say x square is going to be, just correct me if I'm wrong, it will be 16 R square sine square B by 2 sine square C by 2 plus R square minus 8 R square sine B by 2 sine C by 2 into cos of C minus B by 2. Correct? For the time being, let us keep our R square aside. That's just a bottleneck in our calculation. And let's write it as 1 plus 16 sine square B by 2 sine square C by 2 minus 8 sine B by 2 sine C by 2. And let's expand this, which is cos B by 2 cos C by 2 plus sine B by 2 sine C by 2. Don't worry about the switching of the order. In cos, you can always write it as B minus C by 2 as well. Not a problem. Okay. Fine. Okay. Some things will get adjusted. As you can see, 16 sine square B by 2, 16 sine square B by 2, sine square C by 2 will get adjusted when these two multiply. Right. So if I'm not mistaken, it will give you 8 sine square B by 2, sine square C by 2 minus 8 sine B by 2, sine C by 2, cos B by 2, cos C by 2. Take your 1 plus 8. In fact, you can take minus 8 sine B by 2 sine C by 2 common. So you'll be left with cos B by 2 cos C by 2 minus sine B by 2 sine C by 2. Now this is conveniently cos B plus C by 2, and cos B plus C by 2 is conveniently sine A by 2. Don't ask how, you're dealing with a triangle, right? So overall, I can say, let me just write it. Overall, I can say this will reduce to 1 minus 8 sine A by 2 sine B by 2 sine C by 2. And hence your X may be written as R under root of 1 minus 8 sine A by 2 sine B by 2 sine C by 2. Okay. And we already seen that your small r is 4r sine A by 2 sine B by 2 sine C by 2. So this hefty looking term over here, can I write it as r by 4r? So if you place it over here, it becomes r square under root 1 minus 8 r by 4r. Correct? which is actually 2R by capital R. 2R by capital R. And if you introduce this R inside, it will become R square minus 2RR. Okay, that is the formula for the distance between S and I. Distance between the ortho center and the in center. Now, a very interesting fact I would like to share with you. SI is under root R minus 2RR, right? Okay. And you'll be happy to know that SI1. Now, what is I1? Center of the S5 circle. Right. So that would be R square plus 2RR1. So plus will come over here and R will become R1. SI2 will become under root R square plus 2RR2. And SI3 will become under root R square plus 2RR3. Try proving one of them at your home. The approach is exactly the same. So I will not discuss this because of the paucity of time right now. Done. Okay.
So.
Yes, Arushesh.
So Napier's analogy somehow related geometrically because we're getting V minus C by 2 there?
No, not because you have to have a tan, right? Tan V minus C by 2. I don't think so, it is helpful much. Of course, indirectly, somehow you can relate it, but not directly. I don't think so, it is directly related over here.
Okay.
Next is the distance between circumcenter and orthocenter. Let's say I call this as S and I call this as H. So the distance between the orthocenter and the circumcenter is given by R under root of 1 minus 8 cos A cos B cos C. Again, I'm leaving this proof as a homework. So please try doing it. The process is exactly the same. You make that thin triangle and figure out the one of the angles there and apply cosine rule. The approach is exactly the same. No difference between them. Okay. Another interesting fact that I would like to share. Let's say this is your... This is your ortho center. I mean, I'm just assuming that this triangle happens to be this thing. And let's say this is your circumcenter. S, this is your H. Okay. Centroid. Let me make it a different line color. Centroid. This is your centroid. Now remember, centroid, orthocenter, and S, they lie on the same line. Okay. And this line is called as the Euler's line. And G divides H and S in the ratio of 2:1. Okay. Now this becomes a limiting case if your triangle becomes an equilateral triangle. In your equilateral triangle, H, G, and S are coincident. In fact, all the critical points are coincident. Circumcenter, in-center, orthocenter, centroid, they're all at the same point. So this 2:1 then becomes a limiting case of that ratio. Okay. So note down, this is the Euler's line and the centroid divides the join of orthocenter and the circumcenter in the ratio of 2:1. Okay. So if somebody asks you this question, hey, how far is centroid from the orthocenter? You already know the distance of SH. This is your distance of SH. You just do 2/3 of it. You'll get the distance of centroid from the orthocenter. If you want to know how far is centroid from the circumcenter, you just do 1/3 of this distance. That will be your distance of the centroid from the circumcenter. Okay, so all those critical distances can be figured out from this particular fact that HGS lie on the same line, which is called the Euler line. G divides the join of H and S internally in the ratio of 2:1. Is this fine? Any questions? Okay. So few things related to quadrilateral also we'll discuss because we have very less time now. And we have to also discuss some solution of triangle cases. Quadrilateral. Okay. So first thing that we need to know is what is the area of any quadrilateral? Area of any quadrilateral.
Sir, is it that root S minus A, S minus B, S minus A, S minus D?
We'll talk about it. Okay. So the very basic formula that you should all keep in mind is area of a quadrilateral is the product of its diagonal into sine of the angle included. Take any one of the angle. Let's say this is angle theta. Okay. So it is half. Let me write it. Area of ABCD is half product of the diagonals AC BD into sine of the angle between them. Please note, it is not going to matter even if you had taken this angle, because this angle will be supplementary of this. So sine of that will again give you the same thing. So it doesn't matter. So half the product of the diagonals into sine of the angle between them. So in case of special figures like a square, okay, you can find the area of the triangle, area of the square by just doing half into product of the diagonals. Because the angle between the diagonals is 90 degree there. So sine 90 degree will become a 1. Okay, so make a note of this. Another formula that is very important and very less known is you can also write it in the same way as you wrote the Heron's formula. Okay, now in Heron's formula, there was an S. In the case of quadrilateral also, you will have an S, which is your sum of these sides. Let's say I call these sides as A, B, C, D. Okay. So there is an S for the quadrilateral also. So it is a semi-perimeter. So area of the cyclic quadrilateral, sorry, not cyclic quadrilateral, my mistake. Area of a quadrilateral is given by, note down. I'll write it slightly shifted here. Yeah. Under root of S minus A, S minus B, S minus C, S minus D, minus a b c d cos square theta. Is that fine?
Excuse me.
Yes, sir. Tell me.
Sir, could you repeat the relationship in the Euler's line?
In the Euler's line, it says Euler's line is basically a line which connects orthocenter, centroid, and the circumcenter. So they all lie on the same line. That's what this line is called, the Euler's line. And this ratio is 2:1.
Yes, sir. Got it, sir.
Okay. Okay. Now this theta that you see over here, is half of any of the two opposite sides angle by 2. I should use a different, I think, notation here, because you'll get confused with the formula. Okay. Done. So if it becomes a case of a cyclic quadrilateral, in case of a cyclic quadrilateral, you know, A plus C is 180 degree. So in case of a cyclic quadrilateral, A plus C will become 180. So A plus C, or for that matter, B plus D will also become 180. So A plus C by 2 is 90 degrees, which is also B plus D by 2. So what will happen? This term, which is cos square 90 degree, that term will vanish. So in case of a cyclic quadrilateral, so this is in general, any quadrilateral. But if you have a cyclic quadrilateral, your area will become area of a cyclic quadrilateral ABCD will become under root of S minus A, S minus B, S minus C, S minus D, because this last term ABCD cos square alpha will vanish. That will become a zero.
So why did you take opposite sides there?
Where?
For alpha.
This is how the formula comes out. So when you derive this formula, which again I'm giving to you as a homework, okay? I'll also give you a hint how to derive it. So area of a area of any quadrilateral can be obtained by just adding up the areas of these triangles. Okay. So when you do that, you'll automatically get alpha as a half of the angle between the opposites, half of the sum of the angle of the opposite vertex. By derivation, you'll come to know, Ruchir.
Okay, yes, sir.
Okay. So please derive it on your own and we'll discuss it.
Could you go right?
Sure.
Yes, just a minute.
So this cyclic quadrilateral thing we can extend to any polygon, no sir?
I'm not sure about any polygon.
Okay. It
depends upon the case. I will not generalize this actually.
Okay, sir.
Okay. All of you have noted this down. Any questions? Okay. One interesting thing I would like to discuss here is the Ptolemy theorem. All of you know Ptolemy theorem. What is Ptolemy theorem? Anybody can explain me? Those who have done preparations for PRMO, you have done so much of geometry. So Ptolemy theorem says,
it's something like when you multiply opposite sides.
Yeah, Ptolemy theorem says, if you have a cyclic quadrilateral, then the product of the diagonals, that is AC into BD, is AB into CD, that is product of the opposite sides sum. So AB into CD and BC into AD. Okay. So this is the case. This is a formula for Ptolemy theorem. Again, I would leave up to you to prove it. This can be easily be proved by taking cosine law on this angle and this angle. And we are knowing that they are supplementary. So if this is theta, this is 180 minus theta. So please prove this Ptolemy theorem. So this is a good theorem which will help you to solve a lot of different types of geometry based problems on cyclic quadrilateral. One more interesting thing I would like to share with you. If this quadrilateral is not a cyclic quadrilateral, then what will happen to this? What will happen to this inequality? What will happen to this equation? This will actually become an inequation, right? And now I leave up to you to decide whether this will be less than equal to symbol or this will become a greater than equal to symbol. Okay. So a lot of homeworks I'm giving you because of the paucity of time. I cannot do everything. If it is not a cyclic quadrilateral, if ABCD is not cyclic, if it is cyclic, then it will be equal to. That is fine. That we can easily prove. If ABCD is not cyclic, what symbol will come over here? Greater than equal to or less than equal to? That's what I would
greater,
like.
Greater than equal to.
Figure out. So right now, we'll not waste time on that. Achha, another thing I would like to discuss with you. For a cyclic quadrilateral, the circumcircle that you have drawn over here can be linked up to the sides. And that is and linked up to the area also. So it is given by 1 by 4 delta under root of all possible divisions of group 2 you can make between the sides. Oh, sorry. Okay. So this is like making all possible divisions of 4 people in groups of, in 2 groups of equal sizes. ACBD, ADBC, ABCD. Okay. So this is the radius of the circumcircle which circumscribes a cyclic quadrilateral. Okay, please make a note of this. Very, very interesting. You may include delta inside and you can say it is under root of ACBD, ADBC, ABDC or ABCD by area of a cyclic quadrilateral we already know. Okay. S is A plus B plus C by A plus C plus D by 2. S is always the semi-perimeter. Okay. Now, last half an hour of our session, we'll talk about solution of triangles. It has been a very, very fast
session. Can you
do that? Oh, yeah, sure.
So, are you going to take some problems?
I'm sorry?
So, are you going to take some problems?
No. We'll see. Let me first finish off solution of triangle. That is important.
None, sir. Thank you.
None?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Solution of triangles. Solution of triangle is basically a concept where, see, every triangle has got 6 parameters, angles that we know, ABC, and side lengths, correct? Now, solution of triangle is basically a concept where it says that if you know any 3 of the 6 unknowns, except all angles. So if any three of A, B, C, capital A, capital B, capital C is known, except all angles, then it's possible to find triangles. Why I wrote triangles is because they can be more than one triangle also. It is possible to find the unknown unknowns of the triangle. And they can be, see, with a given three information, you may have multiple triangles also possible. I'm not saying that you'll always get a unique triangle and you'll get a unique value of the unknowns. I'm not trying to say. So that's why I normally include this word S. Because, see, many a times what happens, when I give you three of the given information, you may end up getting two triangles which has got the same set of unknowns, same set of parameters. Okay. So there need not be always a unique triangle that will come out from this particular exercise. That's why I have written triangles over here. Okay. Now, why not we can figure out with this all angles given? Because as you know that if angles are known, they can infinitely many triangles. And it's very difficult to find out for infinitely many triangles what are the unknown parameters. So if all are not angles, then only we can easily figure out what are the unknowns. So now what are we going to take here? We are going to take up some cases where, you know, what are the possibilities that can be given to us. The first case is where all sides are known. Okay, that means if you know A, B, C of a triangle, what are the unknowns here? Unknowns will be angles. Can you figure out the angles if you know the sides? Which rule is the best for this? Use?
Sine rule.
Cosine rule. Correct? Cosine rule is the best way forward. And cosine rule, why we normally recommend is because when you know the cosine rules are very sensitive to quadrants. Right? So you know exactly when is the angle acute and when is the angle obtuse. But sine creates an issue because sine 30 degree, sine 150 degree, both will be half and both can be possible angles in a triangle. Okay. So cosine rule is the best foot forward when you want to find out the, unknown angles of this triangle. Now, I'm not saying this is the only way. There are a lot of other means by which you can figure it out. If you find out the area of the triangle, which you can easily find out by knowing your semi-perimeter from here, okay? And you can use the fact that sine of A is equal to 2 delta by BC. But the problem here is that if you get an answer like half, we won't be able to figure out whether A was 150 degree or A was 30 degree. So that creates an issue. So I'm not ruling out the possibilities of sine rule for it, but sine rule may create confusion. Okay. Tan is also a very good formula. For example, you can figure out tan A by 2 by using the formula delta by SS minus A. Remember, we had done this when I was trying to find out the in circle radius. Okay. This also is a good way to find out the angle. Okay. Similarly, tan B by 2, tan C by 2, etc. But the best is your cosine rule. You need not find out delta and all those things. You can easily deal with A, B, C directly. That's the best way to get. Okay. Case number 2. Acha, one more thing I would like to ask. If three sides are known, will I get a unique triangle for the side or will I have various different triangles for the side?
Unique.
We'll get a unique triangle, yes.
Okay. We'll have only one angle opposite to one side. Only that combination is good.
Correct. Now, next is when two sides and included angle are given. Included angle is known. For example, if let's say somebody gives you let's say side length A, side length B, and this angle C, right? Will you be able to figure out the other angles and the unknown side? If yes, how? In this case, the best formula to use is your Napier's analogy. So I can directly use here and get my unknowns very easily. Okay. So from here, I know A, B, C. So I can use it on the right hand side. So A minus B will be known from here. A minus B will be known. A plus B is already known to me because I know C. So from these two, I can figure out my A and B values. Correct? Now, I'm not saying there are not other ways. You can also go for, you can also use your concept of sine rule. So you can find your opposite C by using the formula A sine C by sine A. Correct? That is also possible. Okay. So a lot of things can be done. The third case which I am going to do, that is slightly irritating. And that is called the ambiguous case, case number three. So case number one and case number two, I hope nobody has any issue. Okay. Case number three, this is called the ambiguous case. Here, two sides will be known. Let's say I just make a diagram. Let's say I give you this side BC and I give you this side B, and one of the angles which is not sandwiched between the two sides is given. Let's say angle A is given. So let's say you have been given A, B and angle A. Then how do you find out the other unknowns from here? Okay, now
then you can have many possibilities.
There are many possibilities that will come out from here. We'll take up one by one in the interest of time. So first write cosine formula. So now C is unknown for you. Remember, C is unknown for you. So this is unknown for you. So let's write down cosine formula. Cosine formula will give you something like this. So this will actually result in a quadratic in C. Let me write step by step. So this will give you C square minus 2B C, and you'll have 1 plus cos A, right? Am I right? Correct.
So it'll be b square plus c square minus a square.
Arey yaar, sorry. My brain has stopped working, I think. Kya likh raha main? So yeah, so b square. One second. I think I was thinking ahead of time. So b square plus c square minus a square is 2bc cos a. So you'll get C square minus 2BC cos A plus B square minus A square. This is a constant term like this. Yeah. Okay, this is what we get. Now this is clear cut quadratic. Quadratic in C. Now when there's a quadratic in C, you already know that you can have various possibilities. You can have distinct roots. You can have equal roots. You can have no real roots also. Correct. So let us try to figure out what happens and when it happens. See, if you take the quadratic equation formula, okay, so what you end up getting is b cos a plus minus 4 will be cancelled out from here. So it will be b cos square a plus a square. So it will be a square minus b square sine square a. Let me know if this is clear. This is your C. Okay. So 2 I cancelled out from this 4 and 2 here. B square cos square minus 1 is minus b square sine square. And minus of minus a square is a square. Correct. Now a lot of things depend on this guy. A lot of things depend on this guy. If if a square is less than b square sine square a, right? In other words, a is less than b sine a. Okay, that means if sine of, let me write it like this, that means a by sine a is less than b. Okay. Now, what does it mean when a by sine a is less than b? Remember, normally a by sine a is actually b by sine b. Correct. So you're trying to say b by sine b is less than b. Right? Indirectly, you're trying to say something which is not possible. Okay. In other words, if this becomes negative, then there cannot be any triangle possible. So let's say if your A, B and angle A were such that A became less than B sine A, then a triangle will not be possible. So there'll be no such triangle. Are you getting my point? There will be no such triangle possible. So if you draw a diagram out of it, let us say, what is given to us? We have been provided with this angle A, and we have been provided with this sides A, B, and this angle A. Okay. Now, remember, what is B sine A? What is B sine A? Oh, sorry. B sine A would be this length. This length will be B sine A. Okay. So if this length is smaller than this, that means you're trying to say your perpendicular is longer than your hypotenuse. Okay. So such a triangle cannot be existing at all. Such a triangle cannot exist at all. Okay. So please note this down. This is first of your case three. Let me call it as A. Similarly, if I should do it sidewise here. If your A becomes equal to B sine A, then definitely the term here would be zero, and you will only get one such triangle, and that triangle will be a right angle triangle at B. Am I right?
Yes.
Yes or no? Right. So if this length is your this length, that means your triangle is cut short to here. Correct. That means your B will automatically become a right angle triangle. So for such a case, you will get a unique answer. So you will end up getting only one triangle possible. One triangle possible. Sorry, one triangle possible. Okay. Now your C part, where your A is greater than B sine A. Let's talk about it. If your A is greater than B sine A. Now let's go back to the roots here. So the root was B cos A. C was B cos A. Plus minus under root of a square minus b square sine square a.
So if we get it greater, then we have to check the root itself, whether it's negative or positive.
Sorry, I didn't get you.
So if we get it greater than b sine a, then we'll have to check the sign.
Right. Now, this is possible. This is positive. Correct. Now, if you take a plus over here, If you take a plus over here, okay, then what will happen? Can I say, acha, let me write it like this. If B cos A is greater than under root of A square minus B square sine square A, okay, then, in fact, let me simplify this. B square cos square A is greater than A square minus B square sine square A. That means B square is greater than A square. That means B is greater than A. Then in that case, in fact, I should write mod over here. Anyway, it doesn't make a difference. Then in that case, you will have two possible values of C, because even with plus or minus, you will be able to find a positive C. Am I right? So this will result into two possible C.
Should we check that it's less than A plus B?
Two triangles are possible. Sorry?
Shouldn't we check that this will be less than A plus B?
Which one? C.
Yes, sir.
That basic inequalities you have to always check.
So won't that come automatically, or again we'll have to check on top?
It should come out automatically.
Okay, sir.
Okay. But if A is less than B, what will happen? If this condition is not fructified, that means if A is less than B, what will happen? If A is less than B, then, here one thing we have to keep in mind, that our angle B is acute. A is acute. Else what will happen? There will be a problem with this guy. Because if I take a minus here, and this also happens to be negative term, more in magnitude, then there will be a problem. So I'm assuming that A is acute angle over here. Okay. So if A is acute and B is greater than A, then there are two possible values of C, and hence there are two possible triangles. But if A is acute and A is less than B, then what will happen? We can only have the plus case working out, not the minus case, because minus case will make the whole thing negative, because magnitude wise this guy will be smaller than this, isn't it? See, if A is less than B means, what are you trying to say? You're trying to say magnitude of this is less than under root of A square minus B square sine square A. Am I right? And if this happens to be lesser than this, then C will become negative, na? If I take a negative sign over here. So only plus sign is a possibility that can work here. So only one triangle is possible in this case. Are you getting my point here? Okay. What if A is obtuse? If A is
cos A becomes negative.
Now, if A is obtuse, the only one case I will get when this guy supersedes this in its negativity. Yes or no? So I will always have when your A is less than B, because then only this fellow will supersede this guy in the negativity, right? Correct? And I can only have when this is a plus. I cannot have when there's a minus, because minus means this will also be minus, this will also be minus, because A is obtuse. So only with a plus, and only when A is less than B, I can have a triangle. So one triangle possible. Okay. And if A is greater than B, no triangle possible. Why? Because this guy has been beaten in magnitude by this, and this is already negative. So no matter you keep it positive and this guy is already negative, anytime the answer of C will come out to be negative. So you cannot have a negative side of a triangle. your basic inequalities must be fulfilled. Side of a triangle must be positive. So no triangle possible. Are you getting my point here? So the third case is a complicated case where you have got three possibilities coming in itself because of the nature of the roots. And the third one itself has two more possibilities. The third one itself has two more possibilities where A is acute and A is obtuse. A is acute, we'll have possibilities. A is obtuse, we have possibilities. Are you getting my point here?
Yes, sir.
It is, last part is something which you need to do it on your own also and try to figure out this theory once again. So in the interest of time, one question can be taken here. I cannot take more than one.
Sir, can you go to the slide before this slide? Like,
34 slide?
34, yes, sir.
So NPS HSR, next Sunday, you will not have a class. I'm repeating once again. Next Sunday, you will not have a class. You will probably have a test or something like that. And RNR has to have, RNR and YPR will have a class on Sunday. So Tuesday, which is coming, and next Sunday, you'll have maths class. And you, any tests, if at all it is given to you, you will be writing it in the evening time because 9 to 1, there will be class. So that would be your last class, I believe, for the session.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. My question is, if angle A is 30 degree, small a is 7, B is 8, right? Then how many triangles can be constructed with this dimension? Find the number of triangles possible with this dimension. So just recall, we have B cos A plus minus under root of A square minus B square sine square A, right? A is already acute, no issues with it. And this guy, that is 49 minus 64 sine square A. Sine square is 1/4. Correct? This is positive, correct? So this is positive. This is also positive, okay? And let's also check, what is the relationship between A and B sine A? Oh, that we have already figured out. What is the relationship between A and B? B is greater than A. Am I right? B is greater than A. That means even if I take a negative sign over here or a positive sign over here, there is a possible value of C coming out from there. So there will be two triangles possible. Got it? Fine. So I think this is all we have for our properties of triangle. I have done the chapter to the best of my time constraints. But yes, it is subjected to how much you practice out of it. I will send you some a worksheet on it. So at least try to complete all the questions in that worksheet. It will be not much. I think 40, 45 questions will be there. So just try to solve them. That will be more than enough for you. don't spend too much time on this because it's just a part of your big chapter called trigonometry. So probably even not even one question may come from this. Thank you.
Sir?
Yes, Venkat.